recorded. If you please stand, sit, or whatever, as we sing the Canadian National Anthem. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I'm just going to quickly share so that we'll get a few things out of the way before we start.
Take the next right onto Park Street North, then your destination will be on the left.
If you are not speaking, please put off your, please mute yourself. So this is Council of Nigerian Professionals. We are having this event in conjunction with King's Court, Brampton, and our speakers. So that's the flyer that was shared. So please continue to share it since we're starting now. It's an event that a lot of people needs to be in. So, on that note, I'm going to be calling Oriafoluwa to say the land, not to read the land acknowledgement in English for us. Over to you, Oriafoluwa.
In the spirit and the intent of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's recommendations, we acknowledge the traditional Indigenous territories on which we gather at the beginning of all CNP meetings. By learning, understanding, and acknowledging, we wish to pay respect to Turtle Island, Mother Earth, and to the rich Indigenous histories of Ontario. We recognize that our work takes place on traditional Indigenous territories across Ontario. We also wish to acknowledge that CNP head office is located on traditional Indigenous territories of Huron-Wendat, Haudenosaunee, and most recently, the territory of Mississaugas of the Credit. This territory is a part of the District of One Spoon Treaty, an agreement between the Anishinaabeg, the Haudenosaunee, and the allied nations to peaceably share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. This territory is also covered by the Upper Canada Treaties. We wish to express gratitude to Mother Earth and for the resources we are using, and honor all of the First Nation, Métis, and Inuit people who have been living on the land since time immemorial.
Merci beaucoup, Oriafoluwa. Oriafoluwa is a volunteer with CNP Youth in high school. And on that note, I'll be calling Oshobuge, also a volunteer with many non-for-profits and a high school student. Oshobuge, over to you to read the French version.
Dans l'esprit et l'intention des recommandations de la Commission de vérité et réconciliation, nous reconnaissons les territoires autochtones traditionnels sur lesquels nous nous réunissons au début de toutes les réunissons du CNP. En apprenant, en comprenant et en reconnaissant, nous souhaitons rendre hommage à Turtle Island, terre-mère et la riche histoire autochtone de l'Ontario. Nous reconnaissons que nos travaux se tiennent sur les territoires autochtones traditionnels de l'Ontario. Nous tenons également à souligner que le siège sociale de CNP située sur le territoire autochtone traditionnel des Hurons-Rwanda, des Haudenosaunee et plus récemment sur le territoire des Mississaugas de New Credit. Ce territoire fait partie du traité Dish with One Spoon, un accord entre les Anishinaabe, les Haudenosaunee et les nations alliées, et ce pour partager et entretenir pacifiquement les ressources autour des Grands Lacs. Ce territoire est également couvert par les traités du Haut-Canada. Nous souhaitons exprimer notre gratitude à la Terre-Mère et pour les ressources que nous utilisons, et honorer tous les peuples des Premières Nations, Métis et Inuits qui vivent sur la Terre depuis des temps immémoriaux.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you so very much. Really appreciate you. So this is just sharing what the agenda will look like. There may be some changes, but this is basically what it would look like. We've already done the Canadian Anthem land acknowledgement. We will hear the welcome address from our pastor, Pastor Adebola Banjo. This is a collaboration, like I said, with King's Court, Brampton. And then we'll hear a little bit more about CNP. We do have corporate members that support us, that allow us to do what we do. If you'd like to become a corporate member, let us know. You will see the details later. And then we'll introduce our panelists. The panelists will have time to talk. And then there'll be questions, comments, and all that and all that. So on that note, I'm going to pass the virtual mic to Pastor Adebola Banjo. Over to you, sir.
All right. So thank you very much, Lady A. I hope you can all hear me very well. Let me start by saying that thank you to everyone that is here today. I can guarantee you that it's going to be a time that is well spent. It's going to be a time that, you know, I'm trusting God that, you know, our families will be enhanced, our relationships, you know, will be better as a result of today. And our communities, you know, will go, you know, much further and stronger by reason of what we're doing here. It's family weekend. And having said that, just want to put a little context, you know, behind the what we're doing here today. We just want to talk about family. We want to. I observed over the years that, you know, family, the way we've always known it, has evolved. It has changed. You know, so many things have been happening around us, and you know, unless we are cognizant of it, unless we are repositioned to view things from a different lens, you know, we will continue to look at family the way we've always known it from our own individual cultural setting. But you see, things have changed. We live in a different part of the world and all of that. So I'm just going to have this, I mean, this whole presentation is an attempt to provide information for us to start looking at things differently, and also most importantly for us to discuss. There are certain people amongst us that are caught up in the family dynamics that we need to know more about. We need to help each other. We need to support each other. And you know, some are going through more difficult times than others. How can we all be you know, a support system for each other? And so that's the whole reason why we are here today. And so that said, I will pass the mic back to Lady A to just introduce the speakers, and then I'll come back and start with my own presentation. So let me put it like this. The way we're gonna do this is we have a panel of speakers and panelists. They primarily are going to be, we're going to be having a discussion. I have a few questions we're going to be asking, but I will be asking those questions and all that discussions after my presentation. And so we're going to have questions. Now, everyone that is in the audience, you're all going to have opportunity to contribute. you know, either by speaking or by sending your messages. But I want it to be an all-encompassing discussion, because I cannot say that maybe I'm an expert or a university professor on family matters and all of that. No. But you see, in my role as being a pastor and having worked with couples, relationships, and all of that, at least I do have a good knowledge, and so this has been born out of a good heart to continue to be a strong support within the community. So that said, I'll just ask Lady A to just introduce the speakers and bring it back to me as I start my presentation.
So thank you. I'm just admitting a few more people. Thank you so much, Pastor Banjo. I just want to quickly say that, again, this is Council of Nigerian Professionals, but in collaboration with King Scott Brampton. Council of Nigerian Professionals is non-denominational. We're not affiliated to any religion. Every religion can partner with us. So that is what we're doing today, because we know that there's so much in our ecosystem that we really need to be able to understand. So I will share my screen again before I do the introduction, just because I do, I'm going to be calling on Emmanuel to talk a little bit about CNP before we go on. So Emmanuel, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so over to you.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us for today's event. Now, for those who don't know, who are we? Who is CNP? Well, we aim to equip and support Nigerian professionals in particular and people of African heritage in general towards sustainable growth, development, and prosperity in Canada. We do this by supporting holistic well-beings of individuals, marriages, and families. We enhance leadership, career, business, and professional development of our members. We also provide programs that enhance our children and youth and try to foster better integration and into understanding Canadian multiculturalism and interfaith. We help our members build professional networks. We mentor new immigrants into Canada, such as professionals and students. And we showcase role models for our youth, so to better see themselves in the world. And we also support our local businesses. So looking back in 2020, what did we do? We gave over $1,000 in bursaries to 4 youths that participated in our Black History Month essay and writing competition. We donated over 700 to faith-based communities during the pandemic. We connected to over 250 general members over the phone. We provided 600 families with raw foodstuffs during COVID, and we provided PPE to community members. In 2021, we had 3 months of language school, which featured Yoruba, Igbo, French, and Mandarin, a total of 56 classes. We had new events such as our leadership series, Newcomers, Life and Living, coding classes. We also had our annual general meeting. All our meetings for the year of 2021 consisted of a total of 85 various events and programs. There's an image of us at our Power of Inclusion event, which was a 3-day event, which featured many VPs of banks and corporations to join and listen on the Power of Inclusion. These are images of our events in 2021 and also foods that we donated. These are images of more events as well as backpacks we gave to students. So what's next? So we've already, our language school has come back. We have Yoruba, French, and Mandarin, and they'll be lasting for 3 months. We also have our coding classes back, which we're learning to code using Python. Our event page on our, you can find more about this on our event page on our website. We also have our newcomer series, Land and Thrive, coming back. and our Life and Living series and Leadership series coming back.
Thank you so much, Emmanuel. Emmanuel is a young graduate with a double degree in law and justice and political science. He's a lifelong volunteer with CNP and many not-for-profit. Thank you. We really appreciate you, sir. And on that note, I'll be calling another lifetime volunteer, a high school student, Kayla Iyase, to quickly do a shout out to our sponsors. Over to you, Kayla.
Thank you for that introduction, Ms. President. Before I start the shout out, please remember that you can find all of our sponsors in our Telegram if you don't get the chance to write down the contact information. Now, let's get started. First off, we have Adeyinka Awoyelu here to help with mortgages and life insurance. Next, Funaya Hassan, a sales representative with EXP Brokerage. Many traditional clothes and accessories are found at Lolito Collections. If you're looking for a car, head to Emmanuel Onobanjo with Team Honda. Looking to buy a home? Yemisi Aledesua is the real estate agent for you. SDA Biz Solutions, best in business consulting. Toye Abioye provides many financial services from insurance to investments. Ms. Esther Adorable Frames. They have all of your frames for your lovely artworks.
Technology doesn't seem to want to work.
Next slide, please.
It's you have the slides, right? Why don't you continue? It's not moving.
Oh.
Okay, now it's moving.
Okay. Thank you. Interested in mortgages? Head to Jane AK at BMO Bank. Marriage makeover, singles coaching. If these words interest you, Bose Fawahimi with Thrive Relationship Coaching will gladly take you in. Who doesn't love freshly baked goods? One in Town provides the tastiest pastries and bread you'll ever try. Lighthouse Food serves many African and Caribbean foods and grocery.
Okay. You can go on because you have the slide. Just go on. Technology is just, it's quite interesting. It's not moving. So please go on.
Okay. Eyes Plate serves fresh food at a great price. You can find jollof, frish, dodo, and more on their website. Looking for a spectacular photographer? Kizo Pixel Photography is the one for you. Any legal needs? Head to DJ Oladejo. Isaac Uluagbemi specializes as a mortgage broker. Want to improve your skin and hair care? Leaside Naturals offers many beneficial products designed ethically with care. Anything you've recently broken in your home? No need to worry. Ola Appliance Repair installs and repairs all brands. Always wanted to learn data but never knew where to start? Triple J is here to help you become better at technology. Always wanted to get your kids extra math help? Beyond Math offers free math classes. Check them out. Our last sponsor of the day is Deborah Ojo, a real estate agent with RE/MAX Center. Please remember that you can find all of our sponsors' contact info on our Telegram. If you would like to become a CNP sponsor and get shout outs in every event and more, email us at info@cnpngo.ca or contact our digital lead, Mohsin. Her number is 647-778-0049. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kayla. Always love your enthusiasm. Thank you so much. And so if you want to learn more about our sponsors, please visit our website. Their details are there. And on that note, I just want to quickly talk about why we're here today. The theme is Family Life in the 21st Century and Societal Response. And it is hosted by Pastor Adebola Banjo. He is a senior pastor of King's Court RCCG in Brampton. He also works in the public sector in Ontario as an IT consultant. He's a lover of nature and his passion is to see people achieve their maximum potential. He's a husband and a father of five young men. And I'm gonna be your co-host. My name is Adejisola Atiba, Lady Abba. I'm a professional banker with over three decades of experience in retail banking and financial planning services, supporting mass affluent individuals. My passion to coach, motivate, and inspire people made me to change from salesperson to leadership. I currently lead a team of about 42 advisors. I'm a lifelong learner and founder of Council of Nigerian Professionals. I am a mother, married with two boys. It seems like we like boys on this platform. And so I'm gonna be introducing our speakers. I'll be highlighting you as I introduce you so that people will see who I'm introducing. So I'm gonna start with Coach Bush. You all know Bush, right? That speaker that is always very, very, that is powerful. So this is a powerful woman, just so you know. Her name is Bose Faroyimi. She's an iTribe relationship marriage coach with over two decades of experience in supporting both married and single individuals around premarital education, marriage makeover, singles coaching, and faith-based counseling. She is also an immigration consultant. She's married with two boys. Okay, boys, boys, boys all around. Okay, so I'm going to go to my brother from another mother, Mr. Ifuange Kumba. He's a senior project management at an engineering firm. He has over 13 years of experience in providing environmental services for public and private sectors, a community leader, a coach, and a public speaker. He is the founder of several organizations, including a bi-weekly podcast, Perspective Nation, and an avid volunteer. He is a father of lovely children. Okay, we don't know whether it's boys or girls. Unless he wants to tell us.
Well, I have one boy and two girls. So I'll be contacting you for your boys very soon.
There you go. Now we have girls in the mix. If you're looking for girls, if Wang has got girls for you.
Yeah, I have two.
Two girls. Thank you so much. Going to be introducing Pastor Joseph Ajibolade. He's a senior pastor at Sanctuary of Refuge Ministries in Brampton. He also works with the Peel region as a caseworker, an avid reader who loves to travel. His passion is about love and compassion in relationships, a loving husband and a proud father to his adult children. So they may be married, so we don't know whether they're in the market for, for girls or boys, but welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah. And our next, I can't see our next speaker, but I know he came in. Yes, I have Michael Okoli. I just want people to see your face before we start the discussion. Okay, I can't see him again. So Michael Okoli is owner and director of IT and business operation at NetStack Services Inc., NASCI. With over 18 years in the industry, he has a bachelor's degree in computer science and an MBA. He's a proud father of three beautiful children. Okay, so I think that's about it. So Bush, yeah, those are all the speakers that we have. So I'm gonna pass it back to Pastor Banjo to continue before we go into the dialogue.
All right, so let's just go straight into our discussion today. Let me try to make this a presentation. Give me 1 second.
Sorry, just to interrupt, is this the questions that we're gonna be asking them?
No, I'll just moderate all that. But you should be having my first slide up on now, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. One second, I just want to make this a presentation. All right, good. All right, so one quick thing about me and Lady A, you didn't say that I am on the Advisory Council of CNP, and that's probably part of why we are having the joint program as well. You know, naturally, you know, you would imagine that on a family day like this, it's always good to come together and let's all, you know, rub minds. And so because of the relationship with CNP and all of that, so, you know, we've decided to do this together so that it will also be able to reach the bigger community. So that said, let's go into the presentation. Now, like I said, it's going to be in two parts. I'll have this initial quick presentation. I'm going to try and make it as quick as possible just to introduce the topic. And then we'll go into question and answers later on. Praise God. So, so the first thing is, you know, again, quickly, thank you everyone for joining us today. The purpose of our session, we've talked about it a few times, and that is to inform and to empower, you know, in the community. We're going to be having a free-flowing discussion later on, so get ready for that part, and that's where everyone is going to be involved. But I just want to say also that I want to ensure that we have a safe environment, you know, to discuss today. I want everyone to be free. Make sure that for us to get the maximum benefit out of today, you know, it can best be best experienced, you know, when we are all open and we're frank and we can talk with each other. All right. So we're talking about the dynamics of the family in the 21st century. So I want to start from the beginning, and that's, you know, where family actually originated from. For those who are Christians, you know, the Bible actually talks about how God created man and, you know, gave him a wife and they started having children. So you can easily say, and in other different religions too, there will be some form of that same story in different religions. But the key thing here is that the original family, the way it was set up, the beginning of it, you know, the way that I've always known it was, you know, I call it the traditional family. You know, it was set up with the man, you know, with a woman, and they have children. Sometimes they have pets, all of them living under the same roof. And this is the picture that I grew up with. You know, my dad would go to work, and, you know, sometimes you, you know, in some families you have men are working, women will be the one, you know, stay home mom and things like that. That whole original traditional setup, you know. And in those days, I remember we used to have sometimes 10 children, sometimes 12, maybe even up to 15 in some cases, you know. That's how big the families were, you know, in those days. But nowadays, we're talking about the dynamics of family life. How have things been changing, you know, over this year? So we see that families have begun to shrunk nowadays. You know, we've seen them, you know, getting closer. I remember I have some, I've met some families that, you know, the dad said, we're not having more than two children and that's it. So sometimes I'm encouraging him, have more. You only have two girls, you know. How about the boy? And he's looking at me and I said, it's not, no mistake will even happen. So we see that, you know, economics, the global economy has its own, you know, impact in it. And so families have reduced, I would say, maybe to around four or thereabout. So now let's just discuss briefly some of the changing dynamics that we've seen in families. So one of the ones that I want to just, again, I'm just going to mention them quickly again so that we can get into the main discussion. One of them is the one we call the commuting family. So within the traditional family setup, work dynamics have changed, and now husband or wife or the different spouses may be living in different places. So one of them will follow the work and the other one will stay, it will be in one stable place. You know, an example is someone who is working in an oil rig. You know, it could be the husband, the wife, you know, and you know, they'll be there and then they'll just come home at certain times of the year to spend time with the family, you know. So they're just commuting and they're spending time here and there. Another type that you can easily, you've all seen some of these, is the one we call cohabitation, you know, where couples live together without necessarily being married. In law, sometimes it's called common law, because the law recognizes it. And some just feel that, you know what, let's just you know, stay together. Some do it before marriage and say, let's find out what it's like. But you see, the important thing is that we can still look at them as a family. You know, they've decided to live together. Some will have children. Marriage is not in the picture, but it's a cohabitation. It's common law. It's a family. That's it. Another thing that is emerging, which I've seen, you know, it's getting more and more of late, but it's not that common yet, but it's getting more and more of late. It's the one I just call the virtual reality type family. And what do I mean by that? You know, I've seen, you know, some people will decide that they want to live with inanimate objects or inanimate family members. So they will have a few dolls, like a man will have maybe three or four dolls that are living with him in the house, and he's dressing them up, he's talking to them. And you know, they've been interviewed and say, why do you have this? Well, he says, this one doesn't talk back to me. They all listen to me, you know, and he dresses them differently and so on and so forth. And sometimes some of them is even of late, we're even seeing the, you know, the metaverse version of the family, whereby you enter into the metaverse, you know, and you can have your home there, you can have family members there, and you know, you create your own family reality in the metaverse. So again, moving on quickly, another type of marriage that another type of family that we're seeing, you know, showing up nowadays is the one I call the interracial or cross-cultural, you know, families, you know, whereby people from different cultures and backgrounds, they come together, different ethnic groups, even religion, they just come together and they, you know, they get married and form their own family. And so this is common. They call it, some of those cultures naturally are endogamous, but then they have begun to open up themselves to multicultural situations. The Chinese are probably the most exogamous right nowadays, but predominantly because we have that African, you know, culture and descent, we are also seeing a rise in the mixed marriages and mixed homes. And the more we have the mixed marriages, the more it's going to keep happening. You know, it's we're getting more and more into, you know, different people, different cultures, and we're all becoming part of it. The key thing here is that we need to learn to accept all these changes, to live with them and live without prejudices, without biases as they begin to happen. Some of us are so traditional, we hold firm. This is what I want. This is what I've always known. But the reality tells us that things are changing. Now, another one that you know, some of us have seen is, and we can easily observe, is the one what we will refer to as the polygamous families. You know, traditional marriages, you know, essentially are monogamous in nature. The law even keeps you within one man, one woman thing. But you know, in some cultures, we still have polygamy being practiced. Even in the US, there's some religious sects that they allow them to have polygamous homes. You know, there will be one man, maybe multiple. You know, and there are even programs on TV, they call them sister wives and so on and so forth. So that's a reality. It's happening. But one thing that I wanted to just say is that, you know, whatever polygamy that, you know, any family is setting up, you know, it's in the interest of that family that the men make the wives know themselves. You know, sometimes I've seen cases where people do it in secret and have secret wives, secret homes all over. That doesn't promote, you know, good family setup. You know, if you're going to do it, then do it well and introduce everybody together so that there's, you know, good well-being. You know, and if it's well done, you know, they're good families. You know, I've seen families where they're polygamous, but they love themselves to death. They will do anything for each other. So again, this is something that is happening pretty common, but it's part of what we're seeing. Another type of family, maybe not too common not very well spoken about or recognized in religious circles, is the one we call the gay and the lesbian families. You know, gay will be two men, lesbian will be two women, and they get together, they want to have children, they want to have families, and they actually can become parents through surrogate women. And the lesbian ones too can patronize a sperm bank and still have children as well with people of their own choice. So that is also happening in our midst. Now, singlehood, I discovered, is also a family. my sister was telling me about some one person that said, you know what, I'm not only being, I'm single, I like being single, I love myself. In fact, I want to get married to myself. And so that's that at the high level, we're talking about, you know, a singlehood as a form of family. And in some cases, you would see that someone who is single by choice may also still be in a committed adult relationship. I think for many years, this woman called Oprah, she had a partner. They were not married. She was still recognized as single, but you know, she had this adult friend, you know, that she would often talk about and sometimes come on her show and things like that. So again, it's what's just talking about different family setups. And that is the one they call singlehood. And within the single family setup, you know, we do have people who are singles, but they're parents as well. They may choose to have parents, to be parents by choice, have natural children, surrogate children, whatever the case, whatever is their choice, you know, they will still be single, but they are also parents. Some identify themselves as parents of plants, you know, parents of pets. You know, I know a lady that has like three or four birds, you know, that she's always feeding and looking after. She has names for all of them, you know, and different pets too. So they are, for all intents and purposes, they are family as well, you know. And so if we are accommodating and we understand that these are families that have been set up. I watched one disturbing video online one time, and the lady was on a flight and she had she was carrying something that looked like a baby. And then the man sitting like on the other side called all the cops, flight attendants, and said, this woman has a cat and she looks like she's breastfeeding the cat, you know? And he says, no, I've seen it. It's a cat. The lady said, it's not a cat. What are you talking about? Anyway, long and short of it, it turned out that, you know, I don't know if you've heard of this thing they call the reborn, you know, reborn baby. You know, some people are carry a, you know, a baby doll and they treat it like a reborn. This one was like a reborn lynx cat. So she explained that, look, for anxiety, whenever I travel, I need to carry this. It's not even live. But she was holding it like she was even breastfeeding the thing. So again, family, parents, not even to a live pet now, but to a reborn pet, which is like a doll. So again, these are all dynamics of families that we must learn to appreciate, accept, and work with, you know, when we come across them. I find within this, the category of singlehood, I've also put some family setups. You can call them single, but they're single as a result of maybe the death of their spouse. But in some cases, you know, they may have children and maybe not have children. Either way, they are respected members of our community, must be accorded their respect, must be treated well, and so on and so forth. All right, so last category is the one that I've called the divorced or unblended families. You know, divorce is one of the things that is rising so fast within our society. We see it every day. It's challenging. Divorce is kind of easy to, you know, marriage can be hard work. So not everybody can stand it. There are mistakes. Different things are happening. You know, it's easy to get a divorce. You just look into an advert in the newspaper and that's it. And all of that, you know. But then after divorce, if people remarry and they have children, we talk about the blended families, you know, they come together, they have to manage the dynamics of, you know, two families now coming together, living as one, children here and there. And you know, this is the most intricate and complicated one. And honestly, I want us to spend more of the time in this area. We have people who are relationship coaches. They are available to help single people. They're available to help the, married people. But you see, the area of divorced and maybe blended families, this is a different kettle of fish. And so we probably will spend most of our time in this category tonight. When there's divorce in a relationship or in a marriage or in a home, some may decide to remain single, you know, and they're happy with it. It's their choice, and they manage, they cope well. If you tell them about marriage, they're gonna say, "Look, leave me alone. I'm happy where I am. Just, you know, let me be. I know what I'm doing. I'm happy where I am at now." And there are some who have gone on to remarry. And that's the one we, you know, when, you know, it's often called serial monogamy, meaning if you divorce, you get married, and again, you can remarry if that one didn't work again. So, you know, different dynamics going on here. But then there is the other side, which is yes, divorced, but not yet married again. However, there is that desire to be married. Why? Let's just being honest and truthful, we know that the natural state, despite everything that is going on, no matter how strong a man or a woman is, the natural state is that people generally can do without help. You know, you can be strong maybe 90% or 95% of the year. There will be that 5% time that you are like, "I wish I had someone. I wish I could just speak to someone," you know, that kind of thing. So there is still that group that want to still get married again. That's where, again, like I said, I want us to pack this discussion tonight. How can we be of a good help, you know, when this is the situation? I don't have a problem with someone who says, "I'm single by choice, I'm happy." But what about the people who want to get married? They're not yet there. Some are dealing with pain, the hurt, they haven't crossed certain barriers. How can we be there? And I want to say, you know, and I put it here that, you know, there are challenges, hurdles to cross, you know. In fact, in some instances, I want to say I have seen, observed that there's been some stigmatization as well. "Oh, that person is divorced," you know, and things like that. So, you know, how do we deal with that? How do people involved deal with that? How do the rest of the society learn and be smarter and know how to relate and empathize and walk instead of stigmatizing? So this is where I want to pack our discussion tonight and enlighten those of us who don't know these situations, and also those who are working behind the scenes to work harder. And if anyone is maybe in a situation or, you know, is experiencing some of the things, how much can they offer so that we will know better and experience and join them in their experience so we can also know how to relate better. So they can always share with us, this is what I've been going through. This is how this is how my day looks like and things like that. So that, you know, the more we talk about it, the more we share, the better we are able to relate and to support each other. And so that brings to an end my presentation. And I'm open to generally just talk about some of the different family setups that we've seen. I'm going to first of all turn to the panel, react to some of these things, so a few minutes if you want, and then we can, I'll just open up with, I've written a few questions that can just help lead the discussion as it is, and we just go from here. So for now, I'm just gonna wait a second and see if there's any reaction and any thoughts from the panelists, each person one at a time, and then we'll go into free flowing. It's gonna be free flowing at this point in time. Right.
Thank you so much, Pastor Banjo. I think our panelists are prepared to actually share thoughts around their personal experiences for about 5 minutes. So maybe we will start with Mr. Efwange Kumba. I'll just highlight Mr. Efwange. Once everybody is done speaking, then we can go back to the questions you have, or if anybody in the chat has any questions. So I will.
Hi, everybody.
Hello, sir.
I hope you can get me.
I'm trying to look for you.
Anyway, while you are looking for me, I think I'll continue. I'll just go ahead.
Yes.
First of all, I want to thank the previous speaker for a well cleared and defined presentation. As I said, I am a father of three, and I do, in the last 4 months, I've been offering my son, like about an hour or two every Sunday, to meet counselors and pastors and talk to people about divorce, because I'm divorced. And I sit on a lot of panels like this, and I have to be honest, this is the first one that I'm seeing somebody put a presentation and actually talk about divorce. A lot of the time people talk about family, and they completely forget that if somebody is divorced, he still has a family. And my experience is, we heard it clear from the previous speaker. A lot of people have a lot of assumptions about divorce, and they go with that assumptions into their marriages, into their private life, and into work. And until you meet somebody who has actually gone through the process in Canada, you really don't know what you're getting into. One of the things I would disagree is people have this conception that divorce is easy. And I always tell them that it's easier to be married than to be divorced. If you just consider how much time you spend in court, you'd rather spend that time with a marriage counselor or somebody to keep your marriage. But if you get to the point where you've gone through the divorce and the situation is what it is, you have to make the best out of the situation. And in my own personal case, that's what I'm trying to do. I use my experience to educate people. And I hope we'll be discussing more about that. Yes, it's true. Divorce is going to take more than an hour to discuss, believe me. I spend 2 hours sometimes just advising people within our community, especially people of African descent, that withdraw your case from court. It's not going to help you. All court cases, when it comes to family law, ends the same in Canada. Somebody is going to pay child support. Somebody is going to have custody. And the two of you are going to figure out a way on how to raise up those children. So whether you go through the court system or you don't go through the court system, you are going to end up. Another thing that I want to tell those listening, especially those who are married, if you think you know your partner, wait until you start divorce, then you will know the DNA of your partner. That's when people get angry. That's what people, when people get to positions where they'll do everything to revenge, irrespective of what is the outcome. I hope we're going to have more time to get into details and some of this topic. Again, thank you for inviting me for this discussion.
Thank you so very much. And thank you for being vulnerable, right? Thank you for sharing your thoughts. We know it's not easy. Marriage is not easy. Divorce is not easy. You just got to choose your own pill. But we know that life does happen. But thank you for sharing. Yes, Pastor has a few questions. He's already put together. And I'm sure some of us too will have some questions to add. So on that note, let me call Pastor Joseph Ajibolade to the spotlight.
Good evening. By the way, the name is Ajibolade.
Ajibolade.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you for the correction.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank Pastor Banjo for giving such a wonderful presentation, thought-provoking. And thank you too, Madam, for being a co-presenter of this program. And I also want to thank the previous speaker who was bold enough to share his experience. Yes, these are the kind of men we need in the community. You've gone through something, you've gone through the pain, and you want to share. And that reminds me of a lady. Many years ago, I was the chair on the board of a church, and she did something wrong to her husband, and the husband just went all over the globe to publicize whatever she's done. So she came to me, she said, "Elder, this is what I've done. I'm guilty, and I don't know how to tell the pastor." I said, "Okay, all you need to do is, are you very repentant of what you've done?" She said, "Yes." I said, "Okay, go to the church, lock yourself there, you know, open your heart to God, and tell God you're not gonna do that again." She said, "Yes." And you know what? She did just that. And today, she's a very successful woman in this community. So sometimes we make mistakes and then we turn that mistakes into testimonies. They say when they throw a lemon at you, it just turn into lemonade. So I know that truly people go through all these very bad stages in life, but that's not the end of it. That's not the end of life. It is not the end of life. When Pastor Banda told me about this program, I said, yes, this should be an avenue for us to brainstorm and show how we can support other people in the community. Today is his, tomorrow is going to be, it might be yours. So we're not labeling anybody here. We're here to brainstorm and find a way where we can live together. The world has changed. The world has changed. There is no labeling again. There's no, this one's marriage failed, and so she's bad or he's bad. No. But me, as a pastor and as a life coach, relationship coach, I say, and please, I stand to be quoted, that nobody is innocent in the divorce. Nobody. Whether man or woman, you're not innocent. There's both of you that are accountable for that. What happens to this pack when you first met? What happened to that? Why did you allow it to go down and then you guys break it up? I stand by it any day. There are some signals coming up. How did you address it? Are you taking each other's for granted? I think these are some of the things we might even talk about later. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, sir. Thank you for your contribution. We really, really appreciate it. I'm going to be calling Mr. Michael Okole to the stage.
Hi everyone, Michael here. And first, I want to say thank you for, you know, putting this together and, you know, having me join this program. For some of us here, I can see a lot of my friends and, you know, families and all that. So my story is almost same as my brother there, Franga, right? So. But interestingly, Pastor Adebola Banjo touched on all the aspects of this subject I was going to provide. So you must have done a very deep research and put that slide together. So for me, I just thought, okay, so what else do I want to talk about here? You've talked about the traditional family, You've talked about singlehood. You've talked about same-sex family and what else. But I think I just have a few points, even though I kind of have a concern about, I mean, some disagreement, but I'll keep that to myself. I just have to add that it's an evolving, changing world, and you would find more and more, you know, divorce, separation, and of course, these are triggered by a lot of factors, you know, biological factors, economic factors, we can list them. And I just think that, marriage is one thing, family is another thing. You know, out of marriage comes family, no doubt. But there come a point where the marriage seem not interesting anymore. So what happens? I mean, are you gonna leave the family that you built? Are you gonna leave the kids hanging? What happens afterward? I think my view that the family can still proceed with or without the man or the woman, or in the same sex scenario. So I wanted to just touch on a few characteristics of some successful same-sex singlehood marriage, which is, I mean, I'm an example. I live with my two kids, and I have one out there, still try to extend the same love, affection, and care that I give the two living with me. But I kind of realized that over time, it's been more and more peaceful when you have, I don't know, I'm not saying divorce is a good thing. Franga has mentioned earlier, it's very challenging, very draining, very exhausting, but there come a point where if you carry out an evaluation, you find out that, so what is the difference between being in the marriage and being happy? Being in the marriage and not being happy, and, you know, being out of marriage and, you know, being happy, you know. So I picked a few points from, as a singlehood family that I have, that it's more, the roles are clear, you know, in the sense that if I use an example of my and my ex, we know we have one between us, and, you know, all we just need to do is to focus on how we're gonna bring up those kids. She knows what she needs to do. She knows how much time I need to spend with her and how much time she needs to spend as well, just to ensure that our child, you know, is shown the same love, affection, and care. Socially, we connect with or without. I remember a few months ago, years ago, when we were still living together, it was chaotic. It was a lot of, you know, issues. And I was concerned really about how, you know, we're going to raise those kids in that kind of toxic environment. But the moment the whole thing was gone down the drain, it seemed like, you know, the kids are more stable even afterwards. So we still connect. I still, as much as possible, still connect with my daughter. And of course, the ones living with me. So the picture is clear. My two kids now know that, okay, even if we're living in a home with just dad, but we need to have a clearly defined picture. Where are we headed? Okay. My daughter will say, I want to be a medical doctor. The other one says he wants to be a basketball player. And we start working towards how we're going to. So I said, okay, you want to be a medical doctor. I read through a couple of stuff, reached out to a couple of friends. Okay, what are the procedures? And we put all that into play. And perhaps that couldn't have happened if I was in a marriage, you know, as toxic as the one I had before the separation. So it's clear, everybody's got their responsibility, what they need to do. My kids wake up, they do what they need to do. I do what I need to do to ensure that the roles and the aspirations that they have in future is met. So, and of course, it's easy to adapt with. They've come to that point where they now say, okay, I know that I do have my sister out there, and if I need to spend time, that is going to get, you know, going to get her over, and we're going to spend time and all of that. So everyone is taking their position, knowing that even though we're still one family, we still share same view, we still share same desire. But of course, there is no There's no woman, and it's just purely a singlehood family. Encouragement is also another point I want to mention. I mean, you find out that maybe this is in my own case. My kids have always, you know, pushed me to, you know, getting another mother, and you know, that want a woman in the house. My daughter at some point said, "How long again are we going to stay like this without a woman?" So, and I'm like, "I got to be very careful this time and all of that." So, but again, I keep encouraging them. Okay, we're going to get it done at some point, but we're not going to be in a hurry this time, right? And it didn't take anything away. School, they are stable. In church, they are stable. Every time I get a report, okay, your kids are doing well. They are doing excellently. And it's showing there in the report. And I feel like, okay, perhaps this is the situation I need to retain. So I'm just going to summarize the other ones. So regardless of the kind of, you know, family type, both modern or traditional, the key thing for me here is, you know, being happy, being able to extend, share the love amongst, you know, each other, whether or not the woman is living in the house or the man is living in the house, but being able to extend that love, you know, showing that commitment, appreciating each other. In fact, my daughter's mom, once in a while, when I spend time with my daughter and I say, like, wow, you're doing a great job. And at times when I say, hey, I don't think you're doing as much, you know, just to, you know, put that push there and say, hey, I got my eyes on her. So, and finally, from my experience, it seemed more like the balance between the me and versus the we is also achievable in a singlehood marriage, you know. So now it's not me, it's me, you know, my kids, and even, you know, the mother of my kid. And, you know, sometimes also I have to ensure that, okay, you know, she's got everything she needs to have in order to ensure that my child, whom she has, who is outside, is of course stable as well. So I would like to, I have other activities going on by the side. I'm actually being recognized by the Nigerian Canadian Association today. So that's why I'm in my native. I haven't had this for, like, you know, years, and I'm excited. So it's a good program. I wish we'd have some more time to, you know, discuss, you know, divorce and how we can manage relationship, whether or not it's a, you know, marriage relationship or a platonic one. So thank you very much. I would rest here, and I'll be open to taking questions when necessary. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Michael, for your contribution. Again, thank you for sharing your personal journey with us. I remember that Pastor Ajibolade talked about something. He said, where did the spark go? And nobody is free when it comes to divorce. But what I've seen in my almost 17 years in Canada is that the country is actually very harsh on our marriages. And if we do not fight for it, or do whatever we have to do, I mean, there's a reason why we got married in the first place. If we need to do a little bit more when we come to this country, Canada, because we seem to see a lot more divorce coming on. That we would have seen maybe in our country. I come from a polygamous home, and growing up, I know that that's not what I want. And I live in a blended relationship right now, which is working. But if there's something I would encourage people to look at, there's a movie I watched yesterday. It's called The Ugly Truth. Try and look at it, because a lot of people are living in marriages that they don't want to be. And to Michael's point, if it's toxic, it's not fair on you. It's not fair on the children. So whatever you need to do, but what we've noticed is there's a lot of labeling, like Pastor Adebolaban just said, a lot of labeling going on. And it's important to know that there's nowhere in the Bible that says married people will make heaven. So the earlier we see ways to support ourselves, the better. And so on that note, I'm going to be calling the princess of this panel, Coach Bush. I liked calling her Bush. So she's going to be giving us her perspective on this conversation, and then we'll hand it back to Pastor Banjo. Over to you, Coach.
Thank you. In short, this, you know, the way everything that presentation in itself from Pastor Banjo was a PhD thesis, and it shows a lot of research. And everybody that I've spoken, I as a counselor, I was feeling it, that see what people are passing through. So if we are, how many here now? Like six of us talking now. And every person seemed to have experienced some measure of pain in their relationship. I mean, some people, so that is typical of what is happening in the community, because we are a sample of the bigger sector. And that shows that a lot is happening. And we cannot just like fold our hands and just say, hey, it is what it is, it's happening. This is the 21st century, we roll with it. Okay, it is the 21st century. The prior speakers have kind of like talked about, where the marriages have failed and all of that. I want to talk to you that your marriage has not failed. You have not yet divorced. You are still there. It doesn't mean that the changing dynamics of this 21st century family setup is not affecting you. And I just want to throw a pointer to a few of those things that you need to watch out for, so that you can still make good with what you have. Because if you don't know that your marriage is being threatened because of what is happening now, you will just, you're deceiving yourself. So one of the things we need to be aware of is that in this 21st century, our lives are no longer simple. Our lives are very complicated. We have bigger ambitions, bigger dreams. I mean, people used to be simple before, like you are a woman, you just want to like have your kids and just sit down there and just be a mommy, but no more. You don't just want to be mommy. Like, yeah, I want to be mommy, but I want to be mom. The guys too, there is pressure on them to pay the bills, you know? And so everybody, life is no longer simple. And that means that there is a huge demand on our time. And when there is a huge demand on your time, you will begin to sacrifice some things so that you can have time to do the things that you prioritize. So at this phase of your life, what's your priority? If your family is not a priority, if your career, your ambition, I need to buy a house. The house is in Ontario now. That is all. I mean, it's good. We need to have houses. But if your priorities are not in place and you don't prioritize your family, who was that? Was it Pastor Ajibolade that said that? Where did the spark go? So if you don't prioritize your family and your union now, and you want to chase after all those other things that all of a sudden, because our lives can't be simple anymore, you want to chase after them, then you are going to lose what you have. So we need to be careful. One other thing, let's come to parenting. These are the generation where your kids will stand up to you and ask you questions like, Shabi, before you will tell them, sit down there. I forbid you to do that. You say, yes, sir. They will go back and be grumbling. That was how we were raised. But this new family dynamics we have, your kids have opinion. They have a voice. They have their interests, what they want to be. They don't take... You don't just say, this is the path. The Bible says, train a child in the way he should go. And when he's old, he will not depart. That thing now has become a prayer, that we are praying it, that God, this is your word, it will come to pass. Because these kids just want to try out things. They just want to experiment. I have two boys. This one of, my older one was the one that dyed my hair. In fact, this is the color of hair. He's black or he's dark. He's not fair like me. This is the color we wear. One day is blonde. The other day it is purple. And every day the color will change. He's almost 22 and he's always, kind of changing his hair style up and down. At the beginning, I was going to be like, minister's child, pastor, what will people say? But man, I realized that the way they parented us, we can do the same. We need to be more woke and understand. My younger one, by December, which he said he wants to do twist. He's a boy. He has not cut his hair in like 2.5 years. Now he's keeping it to do twist. Before, I would have said, any boy in my house. But now, we just need to understand. And that's not to say you condone every and anything. That's not to say we will not have boundaries. That's not to say we now abdicate our position as instructor, as guide to those children. But man, we need to know that things are changing and you don't want to lose your children. You don't want to lose them all because you don't want to change with the times. Because what's the point when the child now leaves the house and doesn't want to talk to you again? In your old age, that you sent them to school and all of that, what is the value to you when you don't have their love and their affection? So we are not condoning everything from them, but we need to know that the way we run family now is different from the way we saw our parents did it, and we need to just move with the time. The last thing I will add before I sign up is that because things have changed, it affects finances. And this is one big area where couples fight. Gone were the days where you will say the man was the breadwinner. The man was the one bringing the money. Hey, it depends on the industry where that man is working on. If the woman is working in an industry that pay more. So let's say the guy is a teacher, loves to teach 5-year-olds. And he's happy, he's fulfilled doing that. It's just cool, he's happy. You, the woman, you are working in healthcare. Your one shift is 12 hours. Even if you and the man, you are on the same salary wage, he will do 9 hours, you will do 12. Every one day like this, you are earning more. You now come home, you are not, you know, like adjusting your mind that this don't change you. Eh? You're not saying that the man, you're supposed to be the breadwinner. So you are earning more. What are you supposed to be doing with your own money? You say, my money is my money. His money is our money. And then because of that, there will be no peace in that family. And then you are losing out. So, sister, Lady A said that people come to Canada and marriages are failing. Why will marriages not fail? Because here, the demand for our time is there. You know, like, you have a demand for your time. Then the fact is that this environment is so anti-marriage. You need to know. See the examples, all the classes of marriage that Pastor Banjo explained. Like, those are, that's the, if you can't be with a woman, be with a doll now, can it big deal? Be with a cat. Like, if you say, I am not happy. I'm not happy in this marriage. In fact, when I see him, I am scared. They say, hey, okay, social worker, go and attend to her. She needs to move out of that house. They support you fast so that you can end your marriage. So that is one reason why marriages fail fast here. And please, I am appealing. We don't have to keep quiet. You don't have to coming to Canada is a blessing. It is a blessing because you work hard for it. You desired it and God made it happen for you. So why should the blessing now come with this sorrow? It shouldn't. God's blessings, they don't come with sorrow. So if, and God is not going to trade one thing for you and say, okay, I will give you PR, then I will collect your marriage. Or I will give you this good job and I will collect your health. I will give you this one and I will, God does not do that. So let us be mindful that we seem to still like have it together. Things are changing, times are changing, and we need to move with the times. So God bless you.
Okay. Wow, thank you so much, Coach Bosse. That was really, really inspiring. I think we need to bring you more to come and talk to us because our marriages, we really need help around it. I actually grew up with a mother who is an entrepreneur. So I wasn't from a generation of, and my father had me when he was like 65. So it's not an old, I mean, it's not a young generation or whatever. My family was father worked, mother worked. So that has always been my own. And I just want to say thank you to everybody that is listening. Coach Bosse actually signed on from Nigeria. She's very, very passionate in supporting CNP. And that's why she just traveled 2 days back. And she said, I will join. And she's actually midnight somewhere around there right now. Thank you very, very much. You know, and I want to talk about the spark a little bit before I pass it on back to Pastor Banjo. A time in my life, I realized that I was actually putting my career ahead of my family. And so I had to rearrange it. Again, it's all about choice, the choices we make. There's so many things going on. You come to Canada, you realize that you have to study to get to wherever you're going. And so you're kind of leaving your families behind. So what are you focusing on? So my focus, I just want to quickly share it, is number one, you have to have a call. I'm a Christian. CNP, like I said, is not a Christian platform, but I'm a Christian. That's who I am. That's my call. Do you pray to your call, whatever that call is? And then the next thing, of course, is your family. If after your call, if it is your career, you'll give more time to your career than your family. Of course, after my family, of course, will now be my career. That is my own, you know, way of prioritizing things. God first, family next, and career next. And to what our sister said, if you're earning money, you can't wait and say the husband must provide. Like I said, I grew up from a family where my father provided, my mother provided. So that is what I am comfortable doing. So even if you earn more, and in Canada, we tend to see that a lot of women tend to earn more than their husbands. And when you're married or you're in a relationship, there's an adage in Yoruba that says, you use the two hands to watch each other. That is when it becomes cleaner. And so being able to support your husband or being able to support your wife really is what's going to make things a lot better. But thank you to all the speakers. Really, really appreciate it. And so on that note, Pastor Banjo, back to you.
All right. Thank you very much. Wow. The contributions have been amazing tonight, way better than I ever even imagined. And so I'm really glad for all the honest and candid contributions. I'm going to, before I go, you know, on my, I wanted to kind of act like a moderator here and actually start going around and asking questions and things like that. And so if you have contributions, get ready to put up, you know, figure out where, how you can raise your hand so that we'll be able to call you, you know, to join. And so mostly I'm going to be expecting, you know, I'm going to be asking questions and I'm going to be expecting some of our speakers to add to it and maybe even some members of the audience. But before I say that, the reason why we're here is beginning to show up. But I want to say, I just want to add one something that you know has been on my mind, and that's the fact that, you know, we talked about so many different setups in the family that have emerged, you know, over the years. And the truth of the matter is that, well, at least to me, it's not like one is necessarily better than another, especially in the setting, in the modern day setting that we are in. No one is allowed to look down on another person. For example, I give you an example. You know, I come from a monogamous family. You know, my dad had only, you know, my mother, and we're 8 of us in our family. But my wife comes from a polygamous home. Her dad had 3 wives, 15 children. I can tell you today that they are closer, the 15 kids are closer. In fact, I envied their closeness the way they love themselves, the way they relate. My wife just came back from the marriage of one of her stepsisters. Whereas in my family, with us, one mother, we fight like we're, And so that's the reason why we're having this kind of discussion, just to say that, listen, it's one is not better than another. But at the end of the day, what's the vision? The vision is that all of us should look for ways to be better. How can we support each other? You know, what am I going through? How can you help me in my situation? If you don't know what my situation is and what troubles I'm going through in my family setup, you won't know how to help me. You may even think that everything is fine. So this is where we need to speak up. This is where I have to say, listen, I'm single or I'm divorced. This is how I want you to look at me. Don't feel pity for me because I'm single. In fact, there are some people, you know, I have nephews and nieces that are 50 and they're like, you know, nothing is wrong with me. I'm not ready to get married. It's just as simple as that. And leave me alone. Don't hook me up with another person. You know, this is their choice. And I want to learn to respect it, to live with them like that, and so on and so forth. So that's where we're going on. But before I say that, I just want to scan the audience very quickly before I come back to our speakers. I want to scan the audience very quickly and just see, all right, is there any question, any thought, any ideas, any contribution before I start asking my questions and moderating and going from left to right? Any, you've been listening, you've been enjoying some of the contributions. You know, do you want to say something, just, you know, contribute or just react to the different setups in the family that we've been talking about? Anyone wants to contribute at this? Just raise your hand.
We have Edosa.
Yes, Edosa. You have the mic, Edosa.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for this platform and very, interesting conversation. Pastor Banjo, you actually gave a very perfect overview of the different families that we have now. And I think this is a fantastic conversation to have and we should keep having it. And I want to thank you for that overview. It was just very in-depth. And also to Madam Bosse, thank you for sharing your son's experience and growing up, showing the dynamics of how families have changed. But my contribution is twofold. I will tell you my experience, and then I also want to share with you on my personal experience and professional experience. So I practice family law, in the practice of family law in Canada, all lawyers who practice family law are meant to give a recommendation to clients about section 7.7 subsection 1 of the Divorce Act. And that section just tells the client we have a responsibility as lawyers to discuss with the spouse about the possibility of reconciliation and to inform that spouse about marriage counseling or guardians, because that is relevant before they proceed with any divorce application. What that tells me, if the Divorce Act, which is a statute that governs Canada, tells me that how families are the fabric of our society, and where there's a breakdown in the family structure, it definitely affects the society with respect to the consequences of that breakdown. So it's like a ripple effect. That's just on the professional part. But as most of the speakers have said today, I completely agree. Mr. Okoli mentioned the intersectional issues. Yes, they are. But from my perspective, not as a lawyer, is that family is about sacrifice and tolerance. If you're not tolerant in a family structure or you don't make sacrifices, there'll be a breakdown. So that's for my personal perspective. And because family has changed, And the reason why you have a high influx of marriage breakdown or relationship breakdown, which is the term that I use, is because the expectations are different and people don't know how to manage the expectations. So I think this is a very wonderful forum to really help people provide referral services where people can have guidance. The church is always there as a professional or a spiritual body to help. The other services that they can get, marriage counselors or coaches. Because of the background that most people come from, and I'm not going to take too much time, they don't know how to adapt to the changing environment of living in this in Canada or living in any other society apart from the Nigerian concept that some people have come from. So the adaptation or lack of understanding how to adapt affects the way relationship works. From my perspective, in my upbringing, I grew up in a home of two mothers. Now, I didn't know that was polygamy, because that's not the structure that we grew up in. My stepmother, we never called her stepmother, we call her mom. But we grew up in that environment as if it was normal. For us, that was our normal. And it has always been like that. So there was no, this is your mother, that's your mother. That was not how I grew up. It was a loving, peaceful, and fantastic upbringing. So once again, sacrifice, tolerance, love. And if you teach your children those values, when they grow up, they would always try to follow through with that same values. Family has changed. Families are different, but we need to learn to be tolerant and make sacrifices because no marriage is made in heaven. Thank you so much for listening to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Adams-Idode. Thank you so very much. Do we have anybody else that would like to add to the conversation? And if you don't feel like talking, you can type something in the chat too. We'll read it out. Back to you, Pastor Banjo.
All right. So thank you so much. For that contribution, Edo, so that's amazing. Good job. So let's move on. I don't need to share my screen. I kind of put up my microphones in my presentation earlier. Can I ask that if you're not speaking, to kindly mute your mic? Emmanuel Mosun, please kindly. Emmanuel, I guess he's not listening right now. If you can help us.
Pastor Banjo, you're on mute.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, I guess everybody was muted. Okay, good. Thank you so much. All right, so I still have a few questions. I'm just gonna kind of, kind of promote some discussions here. Now, my mission, my idea, you know, is for this kind of conversation. Oh Lord, it's not for it to be a one-off. Lady A, now. Thank you. All right, so this is not supposed to be a one-off discussion. I think it was Efoenge that was telling us in the beginning that, look, you know, 2 hours is not even enough to, continue to discuss the topic that we're looking at today. But having said that, we're just going to make the best use of it. We don't have too much time left. I just want to go dive into the meat of it at this point in time. And that is how, like I said, you know, not one is not necessarily better than the other, but there is a stigma that is attached. When you see someone, you just run into someone, they introduce themselves, oh, I'm divorced, or you see a woman who is um, who is, she's no longer married, as it were. And I remember one of them was telling me that everywhere she goes, she's been, they're proposing unsolicited sexual advances to her just because she's not married anymore. You know, the married men and single men, they see her as the object of their, this one must be an easy target and things like that. So within the context of the divorced person, I really want to highlight this situation and how can we make, be able to really feel better and make sure that no one, I don't need any stigmas. I want to shut up any kind of stigmas. We want to reorientate everybody's mindset so that, look, what has happened to this person? You could even be the next. So make sure that you treat everyone right that is in what's going on and be better informed, and who knows, they might even be in a better place than for you who is thinking that, oh, because they are divorced, something is wrong with them. So my first question is, so what if I'm divorced? Is it a crime? Is it a bad thing? Can someone just help me out here? Like, what's the problem with me? Does it mean that I've done something wrong? And so on and so forth. So that's the first question that I've put in place just to force some discussion. Any takers, raise your hand and we'll go.
Okay. So I just wanted to add something. I mean, and I'm using a real life example. Like, I got lots of friends and, sometimes when we get talking, they tell stories about, their relationship, how unhappy they are. I don't know why, I don't bother to ask, but we make joke of it a lot of times. So sometimes they even say to me, Michael, you are very fortunate to be, I don't know where that comes from though, but it kind of makes me feel like, they are not happy in their marriage. I mean, I'm just speaking from a real life experience here. And for me, I don't know if I mentioned that was like my second marriage that went, circumstances, she passed and I moved, and I, in the course of just, moving on, I got married the second time, which means I believe in the institution of marriage. It's a very beautiful one. If you do have that, that person to live with, that person who can tolerate you or whom you can tolerate as well. It's a beautiful institution, no doubt, but things happen, right? When these things happen, what becomes of it? What are the, what are the next steps? In my case, it could have been something that could have probably been worked, we probably could have done something, to make it work even after. But it became more and more complicated. And that's where the system comes in, where a woman or a man feels like, okay, I'm going to take it to the next level. What usually families would intervene, friends would intervene and help resolve. I mean, for those who like to have like a third intervention, became a thing of the system, became a thing of the authority. Okay, I'm going to go to court. I'm going to go to here. I'm going to make it, difficult for you, kind of, and so it's so do I want to be back in marriage? Yes. Do I have my fears still that it could become complicated? Yes, because the previous one wasn't it wasn't beautiful, it wasn't good at all, I would say. Maybe because I wouldn't say I kind of take responsibility in some of those aspects as well. I had a reflection on some of the actions that I took that I thought also could have impacted on, affected that, that relationship. So I lost my first, I was moving on to the second, and I thought that, okay, someone needs to be there, kind of, experience. And eventually, it happened that there were not enough time for us to understand, you know, what we both want from the relationship. While I was, and my friends say, they say to me, say, dude, you just needed someone to look after your kids, because, I mean, what else could you be looking for? And that wasn't actually what it was, but I needed a companion. I needed that second person, just like, you know, someone who's going to, you know, be there. Also, I'm there supporting and, you know, build a home and, you know, raise giant in future. So, but like earlier mentioned, I think the key thing here is a lot of factors are, you know, are contributing to this. What tolerance level do we have is also another factor. How patient are we, you know, is also another factor as well.
Thank you. I think Efwange, you raised your hand. You want to go?
Yes. I'm looking at the time and it's really going down quick. Exactly. So I'm going to be as quick as possible.
Hold on. So I'm going to want every person to final closing thoughts. So I probably won't ask any questions again. We just switch to closing thoughts about how can we support each other? Just some thoughts that come to your mind. So, but go ahead, Efwange, you started, but you know, keep it brief. We'll just go around everybody like that, and then we'll just start off.
Okay. So let me just come back to the most important question I think Pastor Ajebulade asked. Where did this spark go? And when I meet people who are going through divorce or are thinking of going through divorce, I always tell them that attachment is always going to lead to expectations. Expectations are always going to lead you to...
Can someone mute her?
I'm just kidding, it's on the phone, girl.
Okay, I'll just go ahead.
So that means the time is not working, so that nucleus will move. That means the time is not working, so that nucleus will move. That's what I'm asking.
Please mute yourself if you're not speaking.
No, have to schedule the timing. Either they look for someone else.
Who is the host now?
Okay. So as I was saying, I say attachment is going to lead to expectation. Expectation is going to lead you to disappointment. Disappointment leads you to divorce. Like all divorce cases boils down to those three lines. You know, everybody gets into a marriage, you expect certain things. You get to into the real married life, you don't achieve it. Then you go to divorce. That said, the whole idea of stigma about divorced people, in my opinion, comes from our society. Somebody like me, I had prepared my life. Like I knew what I wanted to get, do everything, and how my wedding was supposed to be. I made a wedding which had over 500 people. And at the end of the day, the marriage didn't work. And I was wondering, like, all through my life, I've been preparing for this marriage. Where did I fail? And now you're attached to a church, the Catholic Church, for example. If you are divorced, you can't take communion. You go to the Pentecostal churches, it's also very difficult. You come in, you used to sit in front, now you are divorced, they start pushing you backwards. You go to your own family even, they don't expect you to divorce. So those are the challenges that we have. And for the sake of discussion, I'm also going to push this because we have two pastors here. And I usually ask them, how often do you get a divorced person to talk to your congregation? You know, and if we can get to that stage where a divorced person can be seen to produce advice or tell people about the whole divorce issue, then this stigma is always going to continue. I'm just going to end here. I really have a lot that I can say. I hope we are going to have another episode. Another thing that we have to push, let me use this as my concluding statement. We need to encourage our own family members to get involved into conversations like this. On my podcast, I had one on divorce, only 13 people attended. I'm just looking at this audience that we have today, and I appreciate that we also have a lawyer who came in, a family law practitioner who came in to say you have to go back to the family. But we have to do more. we have to make get to a point where people discuss it before even going to the lawyer. I think that would be my closing statement. So discussion within our families is very important. Right now, we are not prepared. I don't think the African community is prepared to talk about divorce. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Efrenge. You said something, I wanted to write it down. Expectation, three things. You said
attachment. So if you're living together, you're attached. Attachment leads to expectations. Expectation leads to disappointment. Disappointments leads to divorce.
All right, thank you so much. All right, so next person. Yes, Bosse, Madam Boss.
It's okay. Thank you. Efrenge, I was itching to say something and you already touched on it. So I want to hammer these two pastors here. Because he asked the question, why is the society stigmatizing divorced people? The church is the number one culprit of this thing. The pastors, so if we say the church is not no human being to hold. So we are going to hold the pastors and the church leadership responsible for the stigmatization. The way, you see, the church, they believe that, I am a Christian. and I am a minister. So it's not as if, so when I say they, you know, it's because I want to fire them, So they believe that when we talk about something, if the thing is negative and we are talking about it, that means we are endorsing it. So don't let us talk about it so that it doesn't look like we endorse it. Same thing with sex. We know that infidelity is happening in church. We say, if we talk about it, we are exposing just see no evil, talk no evil. So they have that attitude to divorce. And because that is the attitude, everybody, you lift your congregation to have an opinion. Your job is to instruct, is to teach and give guidance. But when you abdicate your responsibility there, you are not doing it. Then me as a follower, me too, I will just, this person is divorced. It must not be good. I will make my own opinion. But you need to teach us what to think. See, in other religions, they do it. What is the essence of you having followership when you can't shape their mindsets? When you cannot shape their attitude, you cannot shape the way what they believe. We are good in shaping people in believing, okay, what is expressly written as per God's word. But those other things that, you know, is neither here nor there, you leave us to make a decision. And then we can make our decision by reading your body language. And what's your body language? You will never make a divorced person a pastor. If your church member comes to you and say, hey, there's this guy that is, you know, interested in me. They say, he's divorced. He's divorced. No. It's like you cannot even marry a divorcee. So if it is your own brother or your son that is divorced, you will say that person is doomed. The person must not marry. The church will not want to marry. We don't want to join. If somebody is divorced and you want to marry, you will say you are not doing that wedding. You give us all this body language. You will not say, hey, you should hate the divorced people, but you show us things that makes us believe that divorced person is doomed and the person should be treated as a second class citizen. So if we want to start to change the narrative, the church has a lot to do. And that is not to say you endorse divorce. Divorce is not good. It hurts everybody. That's why God hates it. You know, but God hates mother. Mother happen. God hates many other things. They happen. So will we now say because these things are happening, we should now not help the people, or we should now start to say, society is bad. It hurts the living. God forbid that you have somebody in your family that commits suicide. Everybody is hurt. But should we now not talk about it, not help anybody? So the church needs to talk, and the church needs to teach and give instruction that because somebody is divorced, it is not a failure on the person's part. I had a session with a couple today. They've been working through their problems. I had this session 2 years ago. They came back. And then the guy was telling us that God told him he should divorce, that divorce is the solution. I said, see, I don't like to argue with my people, with counselors, counselors. But when you bring a theological something inside it, the preacher in me will not allow you to rest. I said, God cannot give you an instruction that violates his expressly written word. God cannot say, go and divorce your wife. Please, say you are tired. Eh? This thing isn't working. And based on my wisdom, I think we should just go our separate ways. I said, that's good. Don't blame it on God. So let us know, let's teach people what is right, what is acceptable. We should not be like the ostrich that keep burying his head in the sand, just pretending as if the problem is not there. The problem is there. It's staring us in the face, and we are endorsing this stereotyping of people putting down divorcee. So lastly, please, go for counseling. Michael, you said that some of your friends, self, they are not happy in their marriage. Please, I am here. Please, see, this is what I do. This is how I sit down with people, and I help them. So let us not suffer in silence. Let's go out. If you want to do relationship, this thing is not about your age. It's not about your age, and it's not because you have experience. I've done it before. Go and get counsel, you know, and have clarity and understand the new path you want to follow. So counseling, if you are divorced, please, I'm here. I work with married, single, and everybody in between. God bless you.
Thank you, Madam Boss. Pastor Joe.
Thank you very much, Madam Boss. That's a very good analogy to what's going on. I'm just going to talk on two things. The first one is about the church, she said. And I'm going to tell you what's happening in the church. The church that I know, is we profess solutions. We're trying to tell people not to go into divorce. We're trying so much that people should not go to divorce. Divorce is nasty. Everybody knows that. It's very nasty. Who wants to throw himself into the fire when you know it's very nasty? I said earlier, where is the sparks? Where is the sparks? So, and then when you're married, everyone has expectations. I remember many years ago, I remember very well, my wife told me, he said, Pastor, your expectation is too much. And honestly, I listened to her. She said, your expectation is too much. This is why we're having all these misunderstandings. And I went back to my bed and I reassessed myself. I own up to some of the things I've been doing. And I, you see, I'm not saying you should lower your expectation. You can remodel your expectation. So I remodeled my expectations. And we, right now we're fantastic friends, husband and wife. I let her do what she wanted to do. Now she's an executive director of a big organization here in Toronto because I lowered my expectations. No, not really lower, but remodeled my expectations. She's happy, I'm happy. So like you said about, one of you mentioned something about what we do, what the church is not helping. The church that I know, I say it again, will help people, will help the congregations. I've told you about a lady that did something wrong in her marriage. And then she came to me then. I wasn't even a pastor many years ago, but I was an elder in the church. I was the chair of the board of directors of the church. And she said, elder, this is what I have done. I said, is it bad or good? She said, bad. Are you remorseful? I said, yes. I said, I'm going to talk to the pastor, but don't do it again. What we're trying to do is, these days, we are like the lady that was brought to Jesus. Sorry, I'm going to bring a Bible study into this. A lady that was brought to Jesus and said, you commit adultery. Oh, we have to stone her. We have to stone her, kill her. Did they bring the man that she committed the adultery with? Or she committed adultery herself alone? And what did Jesus say? And we all know the story. That's the kind of thing we're doing these days. We're not crucifying people again. We try to tell our congregations not to even go into adultery. Somebody mentioned that the relationship is toxic. What made it toxic? What made it toxic? You saw a lady or you saw the man. The man is so handsome, you know, a nice build or whatever. The lady is so beautiful, you know, everything, all good shapes and everything. And then you proposed. And then 1, 2, 3, 4 years later, you say, oh, your relationship is toxic. Why? Because you want to do things that you're not supposed to be doing. Or you want to eat your cake and have it. Sorry, I'm talking as a minister now. But if you listen, if both of us listen to one another, and I really appreciate the two speakers that are going through this divorce. They're out with it, they're bold enough, and they want to listen. Honestly, each and every one of us, we have challenges everywhere. Even the pastors do, we have challenges. But we know how to handle these challenges. When my wife told me, Pastor, your expectations are too high, I remodeled my expectations. And then it's not that we're not encouraging divorcees in our churches. No, far from it. In fact, in my church, I have a lady that's a divorcee, and she's contributing actively well in the church. Actively well in the church. So the church is not a place for saints. It's for sinners. We have to come in there. 3 weeks ago, I was ministering. I said, I want every pastor that I bring to this church. When you minister, you must make sure that people leave the church swinging their car keys, that they are happy. Because this place is for sinners. It's not for saints. And then you come and then you lambast everybody again. Someone that is hurting already, they're hurting already. And then you come and say, oh, condemn them. You've done that. You say, no. Make everybody feel at home. This is the house of God. Honestly, this is what I practice in my church and the people and the pastors that I know. So if you're hurt and you're divorced, and I quite appreciate Michael, she said, I love marriage. My advice to you, Michael, first of all, own up. Own up yourself. What you've been doing that is wrong. Only you know. I won't know. Nobody else's know. But only you. So own up. Re-examine yourself. And then go into a new relationship with remodeling your expectations. I'm not saying you shouldn't have expectations. Every one of us has expectations. But remodel it so that the lady you're going to meet will align with that. Accommodate her. And you'll see. Your marriage is going to be very successful. And that's good to every one of us that are in this category. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Joe. So we're going to round up now. And before I hand back to Lady A, I just want to, you know, kind of clear the air. So what led to this program, because again, it was, you know, designed, originated, you know, when God impressed upon my heart, and I didn't want it to be a church program. I wanted it to be something that was in the community, because it's a message for the community. So I approached Lady A to, you know, let's partner on this and all of that, and that's why we're here today. So it's what I'm trying to say is that it's the church. It's the church working indirectly, also trying to correct what seemingly seems we are the church is not being, you know, sensitive enough, as it were. So that's why we're doing this, so that we continue to speak up. You know, unfortunately, the avenue is not so easy or conducive like that in the church, but when we bring it to the community, it's a better atmosphere, it's easier, more people are hearing, and so on and so forth. So we're on the right track. I didn't intend this to be a one-off. I'm hoping that we'll set this up sooner than later to have a follow-up conversation. I'm really, really looking forward to all the speakers, you know, let's, partner continue to have this kind of,
discussion. Now, let me round up by saying this. God gave me this idea, it was like married people seem to have the coaches, you know, other pastors, several marriage programs to support them. You know, Madam Boss is here. You know, single people also have lots of programs. But who is there to really be like a divorce coach, as it were? You know, I don't, you know, something along those lines. Like, how do we walk through those journeys? It's an uncharted territory. It's a delicate territory. It's difficult to even have participation. You know, those going through it are, you know, not even ready to talk. So this is what has borne what we're doing today. And I'm really praying and hoping that we can have more discussion to help ourselves and to help any other person that either comes in, because it will happen again. It will definitely happen. And how do we walk through it? And if I'm in, how do I navigate? I want to get married again from a divorce. What can I gain from someone who has remarried that will help me? Because, you know, I mean, the other day I was, you know, trying to matchmake a lady in our church, and she's probably in her 30s, late 30s. And this was like a 50-year-old man and not even married before. As soon as she had 50, no, pastor, don't even, who do you think I am? You know, I don't even want to, no, don't talk to me. How much more someone who's been married and has kids, you know, and you want to, you're going to get married, you know? So it's a whole different ball game. But anyways, I want to thank every one of you for being here, for helping, for sharing, for contributing. It's amazing. It's way more than I could have expected. What I'm hoping to do next is, you know, to have a follow-up conversation, and, you know, take it further to another level, and have as many and get this message out in the community. You know, I think Fuenge, you say you have a podcast. We're going to talk some more, you know, but it's really more and more about, let's educate more of our community, educate the church as well. I'm going to be preaching more and more along these lines as well, and just making sure that everybody's comfortable, and we all end up in a better place at the end of the day. So for me, this is it. And thank you all for being here. Thank you for listening to me. And thank you for all your contributions, Lady.
Thank you so much, Pastor Banjo. And thank you, Michael Coley. Thank you, Pastor Joseph Ajibolade. Thank you, Pastor Fawaimi. Thank you, Efwange Kumba. And to everybody today. Yes.
Just one sentence. So the counseling I do, it's private, but I do it with a pastor that I'm not even a member in his church. So it's there are some couples who are going through divorce. They've already put their things in court. And then where I'm coming in to try to take it out of court, just so I can work with anybody who really wants to just hear my opinion and explain to people. And it's been working so far. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you again for that contribution. Thank you, everybody that joined today. I just want to talk about two things, community and communication. You know, a lot of people said the church has a part to play. Yes, they do. But the community also has a part to play. And the community in terms of families, in terms of friends, helping, because we see things that the people that are going through it may not necessarily see it. We see the way people talk to each other. Again, I say, watch the ugly truth. Community is really, really powerful. The church can't do it alone. And if we all come together, there's another adage. I love adages. Agbajo laughing soya. When we put our hands together, we're able to do much more. And the second thing, communication. A lot of people feel that money, finance, is actually what breaks marriages. I work with affluent clients, and divorce is an English word. It happens in all cultures and communities. And most of the people I work with are not even African. One of the things, and even statistically, communication is the highest, is number one that actually break marriages. So I would really, really say, let's try as much as possible to communicate. What comes into communication breakdown is our ego most of the time. Oh, I'm going to wait for him to talk to me. Oh, I'm going to wait for her to talk to me. So let's do whatever we can to, you know, make sure that we keep the conversation going in our relationships, in our marriages, whatever we find ourselves. And so before we call it a day, and thank you so much for staying. It's 8 minutes past eight. March 5th, we do have International Women's Day. We have a panel of young, medium-age seniors coming to talk to us about the theme. The global theme is Break the Bias. All this is on our website. And then we have leadership series with a young VP. He's with JP Morgan and Chase. Our leadership series is to motivate, inspire our community to know that, yes, we can do it. Don't let anybody tell you you can't put your foot in the door of your profession. Yes, you can. We have mentorship that is going to be starting also in March. If you're interested, we will start publicizing very, very soon. Already, we have a language school going on. We have coding classes going on. All this information is on our website. And so on that note, I just want to say thank you again to Pastor Banjo, because he brought up this idea. We were not going to do anything for Family Day. He brought it up, and we can see how important it is for us to have this conversation. And it's something we will continue. So on that note, I want to say thank you again, and wishing you all a fantastic and wonderful Family Day long weekend. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.